Welcome to We're on the Pier, and guess who's here? There's some fantastic views from here. Why don't you join me?
Life circumstances sometimes lead us for the need to change, to transform. And I have a woman here with a story of a very unique life's transformation. Hi, Jo.
Hi.
Right, where do we start? We start with your story before we talk about how your story can perhaps influence other people.
Okay.
So your transformation was huge on a physical, mental, psychological level. Tell me, what happened when you were 26?
Oh, so I'd left the military. I was a soldier. I was a physical training instructor. And about a year and a half after leaving, I was diagnosed with advanced aggressive cervical cancer. A big shock. And sort of within 6 weeks of treatment, I went through the menopause.
At the age of 26?
Well, I was just into my... Yeah, just 27. And... obviously, that had a massive impact on my life because, in the, you know, that was in the days when there was no internet, no Googling, and I didn't really understand how to deal with what was happening to my body. I was very physically fit, which I think has always stood me in good stead, but it doesn't really prepare you for the impact, physical and emotional impact of something like that. And obviously, on the outside, you look very well. But on the inside, there's like this turmoil going on where you really don't know what to do because you've got no reference.
Right.
So I started my journey of recovery really at that time. Went in, set up as a trainer, a personal trainer, opened a studio and started to train people and get them fitter and healthier for their own benefit. So, it took quite a lot of... doing.
Obviously. And then a few years later, you got another shock.
Yeah, so everything was going really well. My business was doing very well. I sold the business and moved down to London with a view to opening a new studio. And within 8 months, I was diagnosed with a brain tumour. By the time it was diagnosed, it was very big. And I was having seizures, which weren't diagnosed because I wasn't passing out,
right.
So I was awake when they were happening, so right. Nobody really ever diagnosed them. So I had to have brain surgery to remove the tumour, but when I woke up, I'd lost the use of my left side, I couldn't walk, I couldn't stand properly. A lot of thought process had slowed down, so a lot of neurological pathways had sort of shut down, and this was, you know, a possibility. You know, I was told I may not walk, but the choice is you don't walk or you don't live. So, you know, at least if you can't walk, you can learn.
Sure.
You know, that was
sure.
My sort of the way I.
So, I mean, that's, I can't even start to imagine. That's a huge shock mentally, second time.
Yeah.
And then the whole physical shock and process.
Yeah.
But look at you now.
Yeah.
Not
yeah.
only look at you now, but you have actually become world champion in fitness. Do you want to quickly tell me about that? And, you know, obviously we don't have much time, but very quickly describe the process that took you from one point to the next.
Yeah, so over the years, it took me about 6 years of rehabilitation to really feel confident walking up and down the stairs, that type of thing. And then I was approaching the 10-year anniversary of having had the tumour, and I thought I need to do something to really get my body back into shape. And I recklessly decided to enter a bodybuilding competition.
Just like that.
Yeah, I just thought I've got to do something. I've got to see whether I can really do this and get, you know, see the person that I was. It's almost like hankering for the person you were before an event happens. But you're never quite that the same. And I thought, well, let's just reinvent the person that I am. So I just started a process last May and entered my first competition in September, and I won the UFE European Championships figure and fitness over 45s.
That's absolutely.
And 5 weeks later, I won the World Championships transformation athlete with Pure Elite Federation.
And in 4 weeks' time, you're going to?
I'm going back to defend my title at the UFE European Championships, but also taking some other ladies with me that have been trained by myself. And
okay,
my
so I mean, you know, obviously within the few minutes that we have, it all sounds fairly easy.
Yeah.
Clearly, it wasn't. It's taken a lot of energy, a lot of strength, a lot of motivation, a lot of commitment, but you've done it. But not only that, now you're working with people who may benefit from similar journeys yourself, particularly with people who have had stroke. Do you want to tell me a little bit about your work?
Yeah, so I'm an ARNI instructor, Action for Rehabilitation of Neurological Injury. So I work with people that have left the NHS and are now at home, and they're really stuck with sometimes very severe disability from a stroke or a brain injury. So I go in as a private coach and teach them functional training that relates to their lifestyle, so gets them back on their feet, and things that relate to them personally. And I love that line of work. As well as doing that, I also work with people that have cancer, brain tumours, and are dealing with serious health issues to sort of start to change their mindset, really, and keep themselves going when they're faced with life-changing
situations. And you're not just a person who says, you know, change your mindset. You can say, look at me, I've been there, I did that, you can do that. And that must be easier for people to relate to. Tell me, how do people who might be watching, how can they contact you?
So they can contact me on my website, which is www.healthimpactcoach.com. Or on my Instagram, which is at Juicy Joe's Health. I'm a natural juice therapist, an independent natural juice therapist, so hence the name
Juicy Joe.
Yeah, which has stuck for a few years, yeah.
Great. Well, Juicy Joe, thank you so much for coming to the studio, and good luck.
Thanks very much. Thank you.
When asked about Brighton, I often describe the place as colourful. And lo and behold, we have a colour walk coming up very soon. And Sultana Giuliana is here to talk about it. Hello again.
Hello, Yale.
I've recently interviewed about you about your poetry salon. But this is something else that you were involved with as a fashionista, and I don't think I have to say much because people can just see you. So,
well, it's going to be this Saturday, the 14th. There's going to be the very first Brighton Colour Walk. I got the idea originally from the London Colour Walk at Spitalfields. Then last year, Hastings had their first colour walk, and I thought, well, why not Brighton?
Absolutely. Unfortunately, what is the colour walk?
The colour walk is when a group of people interested in fashion and who are, shall we say, eccentric and colourful, get together. They're usually artists and people connected with fashion design or textile designers, and they like to wear clothes as art.
Right.
Some of them paint their faces and look extraordinary. Other people put flowers in their hair, or they wear masks.
So it's a mixture of fashion and an art statement.
Yes.
Right? I heard an interview with one of the people, one of the women who has been instrumental.
Sue Kreutzmann. She's an American Jewish New Yorker. And basically, she influenced me because I met her in New York about four or five years ago. And she was in a BBC, I think it was, or Channel 4 documentary called Fashionistas. Can't remember the exact title. She was one of them.
Right. She was saying that it's very important for her to, you know, she regards herself as a walking
piece of art.
Exactly.
Yes.
And also about the importance of just bringing colour.
I do have people who come up to me on the street smiling. Some want to take my photograph. Other people have actually said I've made their day.
Right.
And if I ask me if I'm a medium, but I mean, those are people that don't understand, obviously.
Right. You know. But you clearly like the attention. I mean, it is making a statement.
I like to be photographed, and right. I have been photographed by a lot of people, but I do like to see the photograph. I don't just want any photograph taken.
Sure. And talking about photographs, there will be
a photo shoot at 1 o'clock outside the pavilion. Hopefully lots of photographers will rush to the scene to take photographs.
Right. And
of the group. There will be a group.
Okay.
So it'll be a group photograph.
And where does the walk actually start?
The walk starts at bar one, which is, you know, by that entrance, the Indian entrance. Mm-hmm. And people are going to be meeting at 12 o'clock. So we hope that people will come from further afield than Brighton, you know, right. from London or Hastings. And there is a website on Facebook, the Brighton Colour Walk.
Uh-huh.
And yes.
Sounds fun.
It
let's
will
hope the
be
weather's
fun,
good, but if it isn't,
hope. Well, I didn't
you'll bring
see
the
rain. I didn't see rain. If not, you'll have to bring a colourful umbrella.
Exactly. Thank you so much for coming to the studio and good luck.
Thank you very much.
And that's the end of the first half of We're on the Pier, Guess Who's Here. Why don't you join me after the break and we'll explore the pier a little bit further. Welcome back. Let's explore the pier a little bit further and meet some more interesting people.
Stereotypes are not necessarily a good thing, but if you're honest with yourselves, think about what you imagine a poet to look like or sound like. And I guarantee you, it's not going to be what I have here, my guest. Poet and builder.
Groundwork, AP,
groundwork.
Yeah. Okay, yeah.
AP Staunton, hello.
Thank you.
Welcome to the program.
Thanks for having me.
I'm very excited about you coming here because I heard one of your poems. I heard three of your poems, in fact, and they were incredible. And we will listen to one of them as well. But before that, I really want to hear a little bit about yourself. Tell me, how did it all start? So you are you're in the buildings.
I am, yeah. I've always read. I've always been a reader. But how the poetry started was I used to write, like, when it's someone's birthday, I'll just do a few witty lines. And Valentine's Day, you know, I'll do a few little witty lines. And then, but I had a mate of mine, Dave, a blaster then, and he died. And I was at the funeral, and the priest was giving the elegy. And it was like a person who I'd never heard before. The priest was telling us things, because he didn't know the fella. You know, we all knew him. And I thought, that's a load of rubbish. So when I got home, I wrote a poem about him, that everything that he meant to me and what he was. And it was warts and all. It wasn't making him out to be some greatest bloke in the world. You know, he was same as all of us. We've all got, you know, bits and bobs.
Strength,
that we
weaknesses,
did.
Yes.
Yeah, you know. Anyway, I give it to his family and they were going, oh, that's really good. And then, you know, on the same subject of death, my mate Les died, you know, and he was a bricklayer. And he really taught me everything. And he was a really good bloke. And I wrote a poem about him and read it out at his funeral. And I saw the power that it had to his family, and I thought, this is good, this.
Right, the power of words. And
yeah, I didn't realise how you could affect people just with words.
Right.
You know?
And obviously it's not just funerals, you also are involved with various events, and you've won poetry slam event.
Yeah, I won a few, yeah, you know, it's old hat nowadays.
Right.
I enjoy slams, it's good. It's good, you know, because you've only got 3 minutes. So you don't get any boring stuff.
Right, you know. And you run your own, is that right?
Well, a fellow called Brian Pickering, and me and Brian, he's the mainstay. I just turn up and do poems. I'm not one of these people not a facilitator.
Right.
I just turn up, have a few
you
pints.
Just turn
a... Brian organises everything, you know, and he's a good bloke. And there's nothing worse than sitting for hours and hours listening to poetry, you know. So what we do is we have 15 minutes worth of poetry, and then 15 minutes worth of music. So we got like a lot of blues guitarists and stuff like that, and they come in and they'll do 15 minutes.
Right.
And they'll have three poets on, who'll do 6 minutes each, you know,
and
then bum, bum, bum. Yeah, you know, and, but I say, if you're a bit of a, I don't know what the word is, if you're a bit of a precious poet and you've got complete silence and everyone to go, ooh, marvellous.
It's not for you.
Nah.
Where is it, by the way? What's the name of the poem?
It's called The Piston Broke.
Right, good name.
It's like a Formula One based pub. You know, they've got loads of memorabilia in there.
Okay,
you know.
And that's
it's in Shoreham. I mean, it's a trot out of Brighton.
And that's the last Thursday of every month. Is that?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, and it's a good crack. You know, what I like best about it is people have come along who've never written a poem in their lives, and they think, well, if he can do one, I can do one.
Listen, I would really love the viewers to listen to your poem about a trowel.
Oh, that's right.
It's probably
yeah.
the first time ever I'm pronouncing this word.
Oh,
and you've got one with you. You have the one with
you.
Yeah,
oh, this is it, yeah. Yeah, this is the actual trowel.
That's the actual trowel that the poem is is about.
Yeah, there's not many poems about trowels, is there?
No, I wouldn't have thought there are.
I mean, I've gone down a library. I go to the library a lot, you know, down the poetry section.
Right.
I've never actually seen a trowel section.
Right.
No, I'll go along under the teas. No.
You're in a niche market. Okay, shall we listen to the poem? And I urge people to listen to it carefully, and the very end is very emotional.
Yeah, well, it's Les's trowel, you know, so he's an emotional, well, you know, he was my mate. You know,
okay,
so.
Let's do that.
All right. Right, this poem's about this trowel, Les Cowdrey's trowel. Les Cowdrey was a bricklayer, came out with something, really good fella, and this is all I got left of him now, is this trowel, and this is called Sensual Healing. If you listen closely, you can hear his flashing trowel and words of wisdom whispered or in a throaty growl. If there was a problem, he'd always find a solution that didn't involve overtime or sudden electrocution. I carried his bricks and loaded his board with pug on a shovel from a mixer that roared. We dug and we slashed, we raked and we laid. Listened to Terry flipping Wogan and drank tea in the shade. We measured and estimated, got it right, got it wrong. Laid an extra 6 courses of fiendish Flemish bond. He taught me the old ways to patch up flint walls and when laying patios, the importance of falls. Listen a little closer to your ear, lift it up. You can just about make out the commentary at a Cheltenham Gold Cup. Radio crackling, tools down, mixer stopped. Shouts of encouragement, go on, my son. Then, torn betting slips dropped. And what does it smell of, this tool of the trade? It's a pint of Harvey's Best with a dash of lemonade. It's a pouch of tobacco waiting to be rolled from the plains of Virginia, so fragrant, so gold. Oh, there's a whiff of Bovril from an old tartan flask and you want to wind the van window down but you're too polite to ask. And what does it taste of, this old piece of steel? It's cheddar cheese and pickle with a hint of apple peel, bread and butter pudding, 3 sugars in a tea, crisps and corned beef sandwiches balanced on a knee. And what does it feel like, this treasured hand-me-down? It's smooth as naked skin beneath the hospital dressing gown, the same one he was wearing the last time that we met. Off his nut on morphine, we laughed till we were wet. I shook his gripless hand and ruffled his ginger head. And 18 hours later, the world's best bricklayer lay dead. Now every time I build a wall, I'm thumb and forefinger tenses. I remember Big Les Cowdrey with all 6 of my senses. Thank you.
MJ from Seattle is visiting Brighton. Hello, MJ.
Hi.
Hi.
Thanks for interviewing me.
Oh, no, pleasure. Yeah. So tell me, why are you here in the first place? Are you just on holiday?
Yes, I am. I'm vacationing for 2 weeks in the UK. It's my first time out of the US, so
Oh, wow, first time out of the US. Yeah. So what do you think about England so far?
Oh, it's been great. It, like, it kind of supports my spontaneous nature. There's so many things to do. I've been to the theater, I've come out here to the pier, I went to Stonehenge the other day. I've just been kind of getting a sample of the whole country, or just this portion of it at least.
Right, yeah. That sounds like you've done quite a lot. Yeah. And what do you think of the pier? You have something similar in Seattle?
Yeah, we have a waterfront. Seattle is like on the Puget Sound, similar to here, the English Channel, I'm presuming, and it just brings a lot of home to me right now. So,
but doesn't make you homesick, does it?
No, not at all. It's just it kind of elevates it. Yeah.
Right. And how does Seattle compare with Brighton as a whole? My experience with Seattle is only from Sleepless in Seattle, I'm afraid. So, what's the atmosphere, people? Any similarities?
I feel like it's more easygoing here, and the architecture is beautiful. Like I walked past the dome getting off the train, I was floored.
Oh, that's nice to hear. Great. And so what are the plans for the next few days?
I actually go to Paris tomorrow.
Wow.
Yeah, and then I leave Monday. So
what a lovely, lovely holiday. Yeah. First time outside the USA as well. Yeah. And the weather has been amazing.
Today it was great. Yeah,
right.
It's great.
Well, lovely to meet you. Enjoy the rest of your holiday.
Yeah, thanks. It's nice to meet you as well.
Ian and Sammy from Croydon are on the pier. Hello.
Hello.
Sammy, the chips look really good. Tell me, what are you doing here today? Just visiting?
Yeah, we're visiting for a couple of days, just 3 days down, 2 nights in the Hilton.
Oh, very nice.
Yeah, so just a bit of a break, really, yeah.
Right, and have you been on the pier before?
No. Yes, I have, but ages ago.
Yeah,
ages
when he was a baby, but when he was a baby, we came
Oh,
down.
Okay, so it is a new experience. And you're enjoying it?
Yeah.
Great, well, enjoy your day. Any other plans for Brighton?
Just strolling, really. I've got my boy who's 1 year old and my partner, so just in case of like seeing what we can see and enjoying the weather.
Maybe go on the buses.
On the buses? Sounds good. Great, have a lovely time.
Yeah, thank you.
All right,
take
bye.
Take care, bye.
And that's the end of tonight's programme. Don't forget to join me, Yael Breuer, every night at 8:30 on the pier. Goodbye.